Good morning, and welcome to the community church. Good morning, buenos dias. Thank you everybody for coming in today, and welcome to the house of the Lord, where we seek to worship God and to love one another in God's love as well. Before we transition to worship, we do have a couple of announcements. One in particular is for Easter and Resurrection Sunday and Palm Sunday. So for March 27th, which is, I believe, the day, Saturday before Palm Sunday, next week, right? Yeah, so next Saturday, the 27th, at 10:15, we're going to be handing out palms and palm crosses for people that stop by. So it's kind of like a drive-by thing here. And then there's going to be goodies for the children as well. Thank you. And there's going to be goodies for kids as well. And so if you are able, that Saturday, March 27th, 10:15, we'll be here. Other announcement is for the teens. We have the SLM Youth Center on Saturdays at 5:30. And then there's also the athletic mentoring program that they're partnering with the YMCA as well. And then just an update, so Pastor Steve is still on the sabbatical, and he's going to be back on the 23rd, and he's going to be with us for Holy Week. And then after that, he's going to go right back to the second part of his sabbatical. So we have Pastor Misarski for, what, two more weeks? Any other announcements? No? All right, so with that, we're going to transition to worship, and we have a video to do so.
If you are able to stand for the call to worship, amen. We're going to go back to reading the screen. and I also want to introduce Pastor Mizarski's daughter, Bethany, is joining us this morning for worship. So here we go. This comes from Isaiah 52:7-10. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news.
Who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who bring salvation, who say to Zion, your God reigns.
Amen. The Lord will lay bare his holy arm in the sight of all the nations.
And all the ends of the earth will see the salvation of our God.
Let's continue to worship the Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, your love.
we sing. Your love is surprising, I can feel it rising, all the joy that's growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through, I can feel this God song rising up in me. Hallelujah. Sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Your love makes me sing. How it makes me sing. This next song is a song I'm surprised you don't know, but you're gonna learn it this morning. It's a hymn. It's a modern hymn. So we have, like we talked about, psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. We sing, all of those are part of what God has given us by his Spirit by which to worship him, to give thanks to the God, our Father, of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so this is a new hymn. This is our hymn for today. And I hope you enjoy it. The words are just beautiful. It's what the theology, hymns teach theology. The other songs lift our spirits and get us moving and our blood pumping. This is a song that feeds our minds as well as our hearts and our souls as we see the theology that we have around the deep, deep love of the Father. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make the wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my rocking voice, calls out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is in Jesus Christ.
Oh,
we continue to worship the Lord as we do the scripture reading, which today is found in the book of John, chapter 4. Chapter 4, verses 7 to 14. Continuamos adorando al Señor a través de la Escritura. Y la palabra se encuentra en el libro de Juan, capítulo 4, versículos 7 al 14. And it says, "When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, 'Will you give me a drink?' His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, 'You are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans.' Jesus answered her, 'If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water.' 'Sir,' the woman said, 'you have nothing to draw water with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?' Jesus answered, 'Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life.'" Sus discípulos habían ido al pueblo a comprar comida. En eso llegó a sacar agua una mujer de Samaria, y Jesús le dijo, "Dame un poco de agua." Pero como los judíos no usan nada en común con los samaritanos, la mujer le respondió, "¿Cómo se te ocurre pedirme agua si tú eres judío y yo soy samaritana? Si supieras lo que Dios puede dar y conocieras al que te está pidiendo agua", contestó Jesús, "tú le habrías pedido a él y él te habría dado agua que da vida. Señor, ni siquiera tienes con qué sacar agua y el pozo es muy hondo. ¿De dónde pues vas a sacar esa agua de vida? ¿Acaso eres tú superior a nuestro padre Jacob, que nos dejó este pozo del cual bebieron él, sus hijos y su ganado? Todo el que beba de esta agua volverá a tener sed", respondió Jesús, "pero el que beba del agua que yo le daré no volverá a tener sed jamás, sino que dentro de él esa agua se convertirá en un manantial que brotará vida eterna." Thank you, God, for this beautiful word, Lord. May we understand your message, Lord, and you open up our ears, Lord. Speak to our lives today, Lord. Pray this in your name. Amen.
Good morning. Good to be with you. And I can't believe next week will be our last time with you. Last week was a challenge. We had all kinds of things happening here. And I don't know if you knew that. If you didn't, good. If you did, it was an illustration, and I ended up with a lot of people asking me, "So how'd it go this past week?" And I was like, "Well, we need prayer." And I was sharing with some of the team, I said, every time that I have, worked with evangelism, with kids, with adults, any time we have done that, there is a spiritual resistance. You know, we have a spiritual enemy. Amen? Amen. I'm here. I'm waiting for that. Amen. Good. And he does not like the gospel going forth. Whether it's the first or second or the 200th time that we have heard the gospel, he does not want the people of God to be equipped with the word of God, the good news of Jesus Christ that redeems people, that sets them free, that brings them eternal life, that gives them hope and joy and peace for their lives. And so we learned, I think, hopefully, as a congregation, how important prayer is, prayer covering. I know that Miss Diane was praying all week. Even yesterday mentioned, I'm praying that all works, all the electrons work with the media, the microphones work, the instruments work, the cell phones don't work, and all the things that need to work would happen. And so that comes in prayer. And when you go forth, when you as a church decide, and there are a lot of churches in the world that are playing church, amen? Amen. It's true. They're playing church. They show up Sunday morning and that's it. They got it. They're done. They're all done. This is not church. This is where the church gathers to worship God, to be trained and equipped so we can be the church in the world. And when we begin to go out into the world as a church, there will be resistance from what we do. And so prayer, you know, the book of Ephesians is about equipping the church. And Paul, it's not a mistake, Ephesians chapter 6 is what? Spiritual warfare. Put on the armor of God. And after you've done everything to stand, stand firm with the strength and the warfare, the armor of God upon you. That's not my sermon. One of the things that we weren't able to share last week, and this is probably the most important thing that the evil one did not, and we don't want to give him any more glory. That's the last time we mentioned his name, is your testimonies. And we talked about, yes, last week, we talked about God's story and your story and how they intersect. And we had three of them queued up to share with you today. So we're going to share those from you. And my question was to ask you to, request was to make them 3 minutes or less, like an elevator tech. Everybody, every one of us should have a story, and we should be able to tell that story as if we were just one stop on a subway. You met somebody, they're like, hey, I remember you. Boy, you look different. Well, this is what happened to me. And you've only got 3 minutes to do this. And these of your members have done some wonderful things. Let's share those.
His name was Robert Reynolds, and he was called Spud. He was my stepfather, and I loved him dearly. When he and my mom split up, a big reason for that was my sister and I were doing too much partying and drinking and lying about it. And so my mom and stepfather split up for several years. It was New Year's Day, 1971. The phone rang, and it was Spud calling my mother. I was so happy sitting in the next room and thinking, maybe they'll get back together again. The next day, we found out Spud died, heart attack. And I remember thinking, there has to be more to life than this. This is so sad. I feel so empty and low. I was 21 years old at the time. 2 days later, I was at work at the animal hospital, and I was alone on my lunch hour. I found a Four Spiritual Laws tract that my sister had put in my pocketbook a couple years before. I'd never taken it out, never read it. Well, I did take it out that day, and I read it. And I asked Jesus to come into my life. Something happened, and I was changed. He came over me. He took over. I met Mick a couple years later. A Christian marriage is a wonderful thing, two wonderful children. And I pray that the Lord will use us as a family, use me to reach out to others that don't know you, just that I can tell them about the peace and joy that you give when somebody asks you into their life. Thanks for listening.
My testimony. So I grew up in a Christian home, grew up as a Christian, and somewhere along the way just lost myself and became independent, away from God. And had that typical story of looking for love in all the wrong places, trying to fill that empty void that was in my heart, and ended up finding myself in an unhealthy relationship, pregnant with twins, working several jobs, trying to keep up a mortgage, all in my early 20s. And so I had tried counseling and unhealthy coping skills just to get rid of this void, this hopeless depression I had. And when I had given birth to my set of twins, I realized I needed to change, if not for me, for them. So I reached out to a cousin of mine who doesn't just go to church on Sunday, you know, she walks with the Lord. She has this personal relationship with the Lord. She is full of joy and peace and hope that she carries with her as a light everywhere she goes. And I knew I needed that for myself. So I reached out to her after every failed attempt of fixing my life on my own and being in control of my own life, and said, I need God. And she said, yeah, you do. And she confirmed a verse for me that I believe you can find in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, that Jesus said, if you want to be my disciple, deny your life, deny yourself, pick up your cross and follow me. And that's what I set out to do. So I cut off my relationship with the father of my babies and became a single mom and leaned on the Lord for everything. He was my protector, my provider. I became solely dependent on the Lord, and He became the center of my life. He taught me how to forgive like Him, how to serve like Him, how to love like Him, and be loved. And He ended up teaching me so much and performing so many miracles in my life. And He put an urgency on my heart for the father of my children, Anwar, and to pray and fast until the Lord gave me peace to stop. And during this journey, brothers and sisters of the Lord came and joined in with me, crying out on His behalf. And this had been going on for almost 2 years. And then the Lord revealed Himself to Anwar. And Anwar had a powerful experience with the Lord, and he became dependent on the Lord as well. And shortly after, we were married. The Lord reunited our family, with Him being in the center. And we shifted from independent living and controlling our own desires and our own life and being dependent on God. And He blessed us with another child and continues blessing us. And although I know this is just the beginning and we have so much more to learn and so much more to do, we are blessed beyond measure and looking forward to what the Lord has in store for our lives. So, thank you.
Hey, how's it going? It's Anwar. I want to share with you guys my testimony real quick. I gave my life to the Lord about 7 years ago. Before then, I was living in the world. I grew up in a broken home. My parents were divorced when I was 10. And by the time I was 22 years old, I've already had 2 kids, a house, and, you know, just living life. And we were trying to build a family with the mother of my kids at the time. And it wasn't working out. I left the house, you know, because there was so many problems. And during that time, she committed her life to Christ. She found the Lord. And that was very foreign to me. And there was this gentleman that came over, and he wanted to talk to me about the Lord, about the gospel. So he invited me over to his house. I went over and I saw how he interacted with his kids, his wife. And I thought there was something special about them. A year passed by and he just kept trying to talk to me about the Lord. And I was just very reluctant. And then the year came where I had to renew my lease or go back to where I was living in Lowell, you know, back where I've always been. And that night I prayed really hard and I said, Lord, if you really are true, if you really want me in a relationship with you, show me a special sign, show in front of me, you know, shake the house, shake the apartment, do something special. So I prayed a whole night that I fell asleep praying, woke up the next day, no dreams, nothing special. And I said, okay, I know God doesn't really want to have a relationship with me, or if there really even is a real God, because there was nothing happened. I went to work. It was a busy day. My first job, I was working at DirecTV, and then I went to my first customer. It was supposed to only take 20 minutes. I was working on the TV, and then he was in the living room, and it was weird because he stayed there, and he says to me, after a while, he says, are you a believer? And I said, whoa, nobody's ever asked me that before. And I said, I believe in God, but I just don't trust that he believes in me or trusts me or wants a relationship with me. And he walks up, he puts his hand on my shoulder, and he says, how do you expect the Lord to trust you if you don't open your heart to trust in him? And I was like, wow, I never gave God the opportunity. I never really opened my heart to really trust his word. And all the words that the gentleman was trying to, that was reaching out to me, you know, telling me about his word, just came rushing into my heart. And it just felt like this force just hit me in the face and in my heart. And I knew at the time that that was the Lord's answer to my prayer the night before. And then right there and there, I knew that it was God that answered, and I gave my life to the Lord. Since then, I've been married to the mother of my kids. I have a career now, and I haven't looked back. I follow him. I have a relationship with him. I know, I understand what life is about now, and I highly recommend to anyone who, you know, wants to have a purposeful life and moving forward, because there ain't no life without Christ. Love you guys. Hey, how's it going?
Awesome, awesome. Every one of you has a story, and don't expect that you won't have challenges. You know, we're not perfect, even though God is in our lives, and God's working in us, and we have him moving into our lives. Continue to know it's only by grace, only by his grace, that we continue to walk and build those relationships with him and with others. Amen. So how many people here love fishing? Fishing. Well, you know, I learned to hate it. You know, fishing. So a friend of mine just the other day asked me, you know, he's trying to get to know me. Maybe we're going to do hang out and do some stuff. He saw the kayak rack on my truck, and he says, so do you fish? And I said, nope, I'm too ADD. I can't wait. I can't sit there on the bank waiting for it. And I remember all these memories as a kid. You know, my dad, every Saturday morning, he would make us go fishing. And so he would take us out there. Sometimes we had this rowboat that was about 1,000 pounds, and three of us try to drag this thing into the water. But most of the time we were on the bank, and I would just remember sitting on that bank, bored to tears, waiting, looking at that little bobber in the water, you know, just bob, waiting for it to bob, you know. That's what bobbers are supposed to do, is bob, and you just wait there. And finally, you know, after hours, it seemed like hours and hours, bored, you know, you know, you'd be looking at thing, and all of a sudden, you'd get a nibble, and what would you do? Yank the thing! I mean, a shark would not have been able to hold on to that hook any longer than a little pumpkin seed. But, and that was my experience. And so I grew up hating fishing. My brother is a great fisherman. We used to use tie flies and all kinds of stuff. But I was like, I'm out. I do not like fishing. Well, some people think of sharing their faith like that. They've tried it. They've waited for someone to respond. You know, they put the bumper sticker in the back of their car, big fish on the side of their car. They wear, you know, I don't know, put their Bible out on their desk at the office, waiting for someone to say, oh, are you a Christian? Tell me, how did you become a Christian? And they're just waiting for that. In fact, I had a friend who has a church up in the north country in New Hampshire. And I got an opportunity to visit with him. And unbelievable. He has the only church in town. I kid you not. There's no Catholic church. There's no Methodist church. There's no Episcopal church. There's just this church, this community church, the only church in town. And this friend of mine is the pastor of that church. And I said, wow, this is awesome. And so we got to meet some of his parishioners. I said, man, brother, this is awesome. You must be sharing the Lord all over the place. He goes, nope. He goes, no one will ask me a thing. I just wait. You know, they know I'm the pastor. I show up there and they never ask me a thing. And I inside of me, I didn't want to burn that relationship because I'm thinking, you know, evangelism, man, you've got to ask them a question. You can't just wait, because if you wait for that bobber to bob, it may be a long time. And when he finally does, you'll probably blow it. And believe me, I've done that before. But that is the amazing thing. So we're going to go along. The first principle that we're going to talk about today, and I've got 10 of them. I'm not sure we're going to get to 10 principles, but we're going to move through John chapter 4 this morning. We are going, the number one principle is experience principle. I have discovered when I was doing my doctoral project and training up my church in how to do evangelism, the one major factor that influenced, moved the dial from them not sharing the faith to sharing their faith, was experience. Going along with someone who maybe has the gift of evangelism or has enough experience in evangelism, who's enthusiastic about it, and we go with them. And follow them and do what they do. You know, there's a passage like that Jesus said in Mark 1:17. He said, follow me, and I will make you fishers of people. Follow me. So that applies especially to evangelism, doesn't it? Let's follow Jesus. And that's what we're going to do today in John chapter 4, where Jesus encounters a woman. We're going to follow Jesus and let him teach us how to share and how to love on different people. Well, the truth is, is enthusiasm. We catch an enthusiasm when we go with someone. When we see Jesus being loving on people, crossing barriers and loving on people and being focused, so laser focused, the Son of Man has come to seek and to save the lost. Well, I'm going to hang out with him, because if that's his purpose, he's going to get this thing done, and I'm going to figure it out along the way by following him. Well, the truth is about fishing, and is that I actually do love fishing now. And it was because, as an adult, our church decided to go on a fishing trip, and we went with an excursion. This guy had a boat for about four or five or six of us to go striped bass fishing. Who's been striped bass fishing? Oh my goodness, right? That's an adventure. There's no waiting for the bobber to bobble in the water, or whatever that bob in the water. You know, it's action, man. As soon as they hit, You're like, whoa, and it was amazing. But the amazing thing was Captain Eric was our ship captain, and he was so laser focused. He didn't want to know your name, didn't want to know anything about you. He was out there ready to get striped bass fish or fish. We weren't going to get little ones. We're going to get limit ones, large striped bass. We're not going to get rock bass or poggies or anything else. We are there to get, and he was laser focused. I kid you, I caught this love of fishing because of Captain Eric. And once we caught our limit, he was a different person. He said, hey, so how are you? You know, and this guy was dropping F-bombs like unbelievable, because he's a crusty old fisherman. And I said, I'm the pastor. He goes, oh, and he threw another one out there. But Captain Eric got me excited about fishing. Let's have Jesus get us excited about sharing our faith. The other thing we learn is a better technique, and that's what we're going to talk about today. And the third thing is we gain confidence. So as a church, as you begin to go out, I encourage you to find someone, find an evangelist. I'll go with you. I promise, if you invite me, if you have an outreach and you want me to go with you, I will go with you, because I've had other evangelists go with me. And that was how powerful it was. When we went out, one of the women, after sharing it in a park, we went to a park, she says, "I now realize that people are open to Jesus in New England. I now realize that people are open to Jesus." You might think, okay, I got to go share my faith, but nobody wants to hear me. They're not open. And she discovered as she went out that people were open to Jesus. John chapter 4. We're in John chapter 4 this morning. It says the first thing we notice in here that this story is 42 verses long. And so that got me questioning. I wonder what the longest story that John records in his gospel. And you know what it is? 44 verses, the story of Lazarus. Well, that makes sense. Lazarus was Jesus' best friend. And so to tell the story and spend as much time as possible, as much ink and as much papyrus or whatever he was writing on the original manuscripts, it was okay for him to spend that on Lazarus. But on a Samaritan woman? To spend 42 verses, of course the verse numbers were put in later on, but the second longest story in the Gospel of John is this story. And so it brings me to think of the question, I wonder how impactful this story of this woman was for John, who is coming alongside of Jesus, watching his enthusiasm, his love, crossing barriers and engaging a conversation with the Samaritan woman. So first verse 1 through 4 says, "Now he learned the Pharisees had heard that he was gaining and baptizing more disciples than Jesus, although in fact it was not Jesus who baptized, but his disciples. So he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria." Don't lose those last sentence. "Now he had to go through Samaria." Now, you picture in geography in your mind the Bible maps, and if you have it in the back of your Bible, right? You have Judea in the south, Galilee in the north, and over here to the west, you have, don't have to carry this? I can't do it. Okay. And you have over to the west, Samaria. And so they could have just as easily put it in their GPS. If the disciples had a GPS, they would have still told Jesus, "You're lost. You're going the wrong way. This is not the most efficient way to go to Galilee. You don't go through Samaria. That's an alternate route that's going to add a certain amount of hours and days onto our travel here. Don't you have a GPS, Jesus?" And he would have said, "Yes, it's called the Holy Spirit." It says, "Now he had to go through Samaria." We talked about the sent principle. Remember, we talked about being witnesses, empowered, spirit-empowered witnesses, sent spirit witnesses. Well, God wants us to be sent. And there may be people in our lives, and by the way, Samaritans weren't the favorite people of the Jews. And if you want to, a lot of preachers will tell that, and that's probably the one thing you know about it, is that for a Jew to go through Samaria was not a good thing. They were like cult leaders. You didn't want to go to these weird people that had distorted Judaism over the history of that nation. They had distorted it, and you don't want to hang out with Samaritans because you might catch the cult cooties or something from these Samaritans. But Jesus decided, "I have to go through Samaria." So the question this morning is, where is God saying, maybe you've been avoiding certain people in your life that he wants you to share, that he wants you to become friends with and begin engage conversation? We are to be led by the Spirit of God. And we're going to talk a little more about that next week, about being led and Philip in Acts chapter 8. But just obey. When God says go, go. Love on the person. Probably the most difficult person is the one that God is calling you to. And it says he had to go through Samaria. Number 3, incarnation. We The other thing we discover here is, in verse 5 through 6, So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, and near the plot of the ground of Jacob he had given his son Joseph. Joseph's well was there. Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well, and it was noon. It was high noon. It was the hottest time of the day, and Jesus was tired. What? Wait a minute. Son of God? Tired? How could that be? Well, we know that the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. He was just as human as we are. And that was a purposeful thing. God could have come down in all of his glory to bring salvation, but instead he came as a babe. Incarnation, that whole thing of Christmas, it's all about incarnation, that Jesus was just like us. And it was a purposeful thing that he would become like us. For we do not, Hebrews 4:15 says, we do not have a high priest who's unable to sympathize with our weakness, but in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Face it, folks, we are subject to sin. Just because we are redeemed, washed in the blood, children of God, filled with the Holy Spirit, doesn't mean that our cars don't break down. Amen? Our cars break down. Our bodies break down. We get tired. We get irritable. We get whatever. We have these things that happen because we live in a fallen world. God has not taken us out of the world. He's kept us in the world that we might be the light of the world in the world. And so we suffer with people. And so things happen along with us. And so we are thrown in with people. Well, if you know me for any length of time or ever ride in the car with me, you realize I have a thing about speed. No amen. Good. I didn't hear any amens from the front row. That's good. Yeah, he does. And one day I was stopped for speeding. I was in a town I didn't know very much. I didn't know what the speed limit was in that town. I'm driving through this town. Next thing, I'm going up a hill, and a guy, oh no, pulls me over. This was before COVID. And so I get this summons and say, I'm going to go to court. I'm going to fight it because I'm going to, you know, try to prove it, make my case, everything. COVID happens. There are no court cases. Not a single court case is taking place because it's COVID. They don't know what to do with it. Well, comes to August or September, finally the courts say, we're going to open up the courts. And so I was one of the first people to actually go through this traffic court here in Massachusetts. And so I got there early, and I saw a bunch of people, and we were all lost. All of us had no idea what door to go in. So the court went to one. No, not that door. That, okay, no, not that door. No. So we're trying to figure it out. And all the court officials are just as confused as we are. We're all confused, trying to figure out how to do this thing called trial court, traffic court. And so along the way, I met this man. He was wearing his Vietnam vet hat on, and I started a conversation with him. Just because I'm a military vet. Come on, I'm a vet. I, you know, reached out to this Vietnam vet, and we had a little conversation, and then I got through, and I was acquitted. Thank you, Lord. And so I went back to my car, and lo and behold, that vet, his car was parked right next to mine. And so I started having this conversation. It's like, oh, great, how did it go? Good. That, man, I guess that's all they want to do. Just get them off the docket. Get all these speeders off the docket. We don't have to want to see them ever again. Not in COVID. Okay, thank you, Lord. So we had this conversation. He told me that he had twin daughters, and both of them had died of overdoses. Drug overdoses. Two separate incidences, his adult daughters had died. He pulled out from the back seat pictures of his daughters, and almost in tears sharing with me about his daughters. Well, he didn't know I was a pastor. I began to share the gospel with him, gave him a gospel track, prayed with this man, not to accept Christ, but just to pray for him and a gospel track, and gave him my card to call me at any time. You see, God puts us, even in our stupid knucklehead things that we do, as fallen people, redeemed, regenerate, but sometimes faulted people. God takes us and puts us with people. So I don't know where God may bring you because of your fallenness, where he may take you, to a hospital, to a garage, to a motor vehicle department, or a courtroom. But God will use you just as he used the tired Jesus at the well. Verse 4, chapter 4, verse 7 and 8, a woman from Samaria came to draw the water. And Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away in the city to buy food. Now the disciples said, "You know, we're more hungry than we are thirsty. So Jesus, you just hang out here at the well. We're going to go into town and buy some bagels. And you just hang out here and we'll be back." Okay, all right. So they went on their way, and this woman comes at noontime. Now the women of the village do not come to the water in the middle of the day. It's too hot. If you've ever been to the Middle East, it's hot. It's dry, hot. It's just 104 degrees Fahrenheit hot out there. You don't go there, because the women come at the cool of the day, early in the morning or late at night, in the cool of the day, where they can talk with each other and find out the latest gossip that's going on around in the village and get their water, and they're able to help each other. But this woman comes alone. There's a story there, isn't there? But instead so she comes alone. Number 4, divine appointment principle. God engineers every one of our days. Did you know that? I'm convinced that God gives us divine appointments. That's when God sets up you encountering someone during your day. And it even happens in COVID. I'll tell one more story about that. But he does do that in the midst of us. And it's only, the problem is we don't have the eyes to see. And sometimes it's after the fact we go, was that person put in my path by God? Was I supposed to say something or give them something or pray with them or something? And it always, we have to ask the question, Lord, can you give me eyes to see? First, ask him to give you divine appointments, and then expect him to do it. And ask him to give you eyes to see when God gives you divine appointments. I'm going to skip to that illustration. This happened recently. My daughter needed a mirror put on her car, got hit by the guy, you know. So we went there. It was like a 20-minute job, and said, "I'll do it." So I drove in there, and I went into the waiting room, and there was one of the workers sitting there. And he was eating his lunch, you know, take his mask down and eating his lunch. And so I thought I'd start a conversation with him. "How you doing?" You know, and I heard this strong accent. I'm like trying to make him talk some more so I can figure out where he's from. And finally figured out it's Italian, and that he's from Naples. But I didn't start with that. What did I start with? I said, "Yeah," and the TV's on. "Boy, the COVID numbers are coming down." And that's how conversations start, concentric circles. We start with something that every one of us can just handle. "Hi, how are you?" "Good, how are you?" Okay, we can do that. New England, right? That's usually as far as we get. But where do we go from there? So I went from the COVID numbers to, "Boy, I can't wait for this thing to be over." There's a feeling, right? Frustration. Oh, and he began to share his frustration. "I can't wait for this thing." And then we began, I said, so where are you from? In Italy, from Naples. And he began to tell me about, I says, "I was in Italy one time." So of course, right? All right. My kids go, "Yeah, of course, dad's been everywhere." You know, and we start talking about the beauty of Italy. Next thing you know, he's sharing his heart with me. He goes, "Someday I long to go back to that place, my homeland. It's so beautiful and so just my home." And wow, It was a matter of 20 minutes, and this man had opened his heart. And then the guy came in and said, okay, your car's fixed. And I'm like, but I remember him, and I will not forget his story next time I go to that garage. Here's another freebie for you. Frequent the same places. If you're going to have those conversations more than once, you got to go back to the same place. Like I told you, I think I told you about my barbecue place. Guess what? Monday. I had a friend, I'm having an appointment with a pastor, and he says, I don't know any place to eat. I says, I do. We're going to that barbecue place because I'm witnessing to the barkeeper there and the owner, the manager of that place. You need to frequent places if you're going to have those divine appointments and be able to further them past the experience, the conversation you had. But Jesus enters that by mentioning a common theme. Give me a drink. They both are there for one purpose, for water. So they have that in common. Give me a drink. So he asked them a question. In our culture, the best way to do it is asking a question. And so we have to ask a question. We have to ask a conversation principle. Number 6 is we have to start with a conversation. Ask a question and don't ask them, how are you? Because you know the answer is in New England, good, and you? Does that get anywhere? It doesn't open anything. You have to follow that up by something and try to avoid yes-no questions. Ask questions that will have to give, they have to think, they have to give something. So what's good about your day today? How are you seeing goodness in your day? You didn't ask them about God, you're just talking about goodness. And then later on, you can point to where that goodness came from, but you've started a path. You've helped that conversation, and Jesus did that. If you go back and read this whole story, Jesus guides this whole story towards that, and he gets them to talk about living water, and that's what you want to get to, is to talk about living water. And I'm zipping through all of these things. The other thing Jesus did was she began to talk about water, right? Jesus, Samaritan woman said, you are a Jew, ba 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 ba. And verse, where are we? Jesus answered, if you knew the gift of God is asking you, you would have asked him and he would give you living water. And she says, give me that water. All of us have this desire and this, like Sasha shared, this something missing inside. There's something there. And Liz talked about it. You know, her question, her spiritual question is there all there is? God, eat, drink, and be merry, and party, and die? Is that all there is? Everybody is asking a question. The key is finding that question among all of them for that person. It may be relationship, like Anwar's had a lot to do with the brokenness in his family and the brokenness that he was now experiencing again with Sasha and having the twins and not being able to figure this thing out. And God was going to fill that. And his question was, can I trust a God? I'm not even sure that God wants to have a relationship with me. And number one, number two, can I trust this God? Well, every person has a question. And so we are to find those questions among them. But there's so much I could share with you from this passage. But the amazing thing is, let me say, is the last one, the Jesus principle. And we talked about this before. You see, Jesus began to talk about her brokenness in her life, the sin in her life, the fact that she had 4 husbands and the guy she's living with now is not her husband. And there was some shame attached to the sin, guilt attached to the sin of her life. She didn't want to deal with that. But Jesus said, no, we're going to deal with that. And so she began to throw theological questions out there, smoke bombs in front of Jesus. But Jesus said, yeah, let's engage the theology. Let's honor your questions. But it still needs to point to Jesus. You see, it's no sense winning an argument when you lose a friend. Don't win arguments. Win friends for Jesus. And focus on him. Because at the end of that, in verse 24 through 26, the woman said, I know that the Messiah called Christ is coming. And when he comes, he'll explain everything with us. Then Jesus declared, I am the one speaking to you. I am here. I am he. No matter how far your conversations get, always bring them back to Jesus. Amen. 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 So action items for today. Number one, pray this prayer. You'll find it in Colossians chapter 4. If you go on the app, it's on there. Colossians 4, verses 3 through 4. Pray for open doors, open hearts, open mouths. Pray that God open doors, divine appointments for you, and that the hearts of those people that you have the divine appointment with will be open to what you have to say, to have that conversation, to answer those questions you're going to come up with by the Holy Spirit, to ask them, and then to give you the open mouth. Because sometimes that's the hardest part of that whole thing, is God sets it up, and you go, no, God, I'm not sure I want to do that. Look for divine appointments. Start a conversation this week. Find someone and start a conversation. As a hairdresser, man, that's you. That's golden, right? That's you. That's part of learning how to be a hairdresser, right? Is to have conversation with people. So Sasha's going to teach us next week how to have a conversation. Amen. She's like, what? Be ready next Sunday to tell us how that went. Tell somebody here, hey, I had one of those conversations. How did that go? And share with us how that works. Father, thank you for your word. Lord, is so much. Help us to be a student of your word, a student of you. Help us follow you. Make us fishers of people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Worship you, my King. stretch us to the sky.
Lord, we continue to pray to you, Lord, throughout these weeks that we're learning about evangelism, Lord. We thank you for the tools that we're learning, Lord, that we pray that we can use the tools that we're learning, God, that we can put them into action every week, Lord. Every day, Lord, we can start out praying that you can give us the strength, Lord, to talk to people whenever the people do have our conversations with us, and we have conversations with them, Lord, that you can give us that boldness, Lord, and take away everything, nervousness, all that stuff that comes, Lord, that the Holy Spirit can just pour over us, Lord, and that it takes control over us, over the conversation, Lord. We just pray that you can guide us, Lord, to talk about you, because you are love, and people should know that about you. We thank you, God, for everything that you do in our lives. Amen.
Hey, we're going to get to see Christian play drums today. It's another clapping song. It's in English and in Spanish. And you can dance if you want. When the Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart, I will dance like David danced. When the Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart, I will dance like David danced. I will dance, I will dance, I will dance like David danced. I will dance, I will dance, I will dance like David danced.
Let's do the verse once.
When the Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart, I will dance like David danced. When the Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart, I will dance like David danced. I will dance, I will dance like David danced. I will dance, I will dance like David danced.
In Spanish.
Espíritu Dios está en mi corazón, yo danzo como David. Espíritu Dios está en mi corazón, yo danzo como David.
Oh, yo danzo, yo danzo, yo danzo como David. Oh, yo danzo, oh, yo danzo.
Como David. The Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart, I will pray like David prayed. When the Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart, I will pray like David prayed. I will pray, I will pray, I will pray like David prayed.
Upon my heart, I will love like David loved.
When the Spirit of the Lord moves upon my heart, I will love like David loved.
Hey!
I will love, I will love, I will love like David loved. I will dance like David.
Yo danzo, oh yo danzo, oh danzo, como David. Oh yo danzo, yo danzo, yo danzo como David. Like David dance, I will dance, I will dance, I will dance like David dance.
Oi! Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace so that you might give it to others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Yeah.